Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.
Hello, welcome to Talking Mental Health. I'm Jim Miller, your host. Today, we're going to be talking about a new crisis residential program in Berks County. And my two guests are Pamela Seaman. She is the MHDD administrator for Berks County. And we have Rabbit Lee Sanders III. He's the director of crisis services for Chimes Holcomb, who runs the program. I'm going to be referring to him as Bobby throughout the rest of the show. So let's start with you, Pam. Give us some background on the new crisis residential program and how it became possible. I know we've been talking about it for a while.
Yeah, so recently with the implementation of 988 across the state, and actually across the entire United States, people have been talking about looking at what your local crisis delivery system is and what services do you need to expand upon to enhance those services. So crisis residential is one of the services that we've been looking at for a while. And with 988, the Department of Human Services in Pennsylvania made some grant funding available. So we actually applied for the funding. It's getting close to 2 years ago already that we applied for the funding and were awarded specific grant money to start up crisis residential services. And the resources that we received were for a period of 2 years. So again, it was really based on what we saw as a local community need, a resource that we didn't have, and really wanting to expand so that people have access to that service.
So it was really people in this community decided, they looked at the services and said, boy, do we need, right, as the next step. Now, the Department of Human Services, Pennsylvania Department of Human Services, why did they decide they would focus on expanding the crisis continuum? And maybe you want to talk about what the crisis continuum is first and sure. Why they wanted to expand it.
Well, in crisis, there are a number of different services. So at the lowest level, we have crisis intervention, which is our service that, and here we're fortunate to actually have all three levels of care, which is telephone, mobile, which is our crisis service provider, which is Holcomb Chimes, going out to people based on wherever they're having the crisis, and then walk-in, which is at their location. So we've been fortunate to have that service available to us for a long time. And crisis will go out and try to figure out what a person needs, try to help them solve the situation. But if a person needs something more, at this point, the next thing that typically happens is you wind up going to an emergency room to determine whether or not you need inpatient services, inpatient psychiatric services. And so, again, the difference between outpatient, you know, out in the community and inpatient is huge, which is why we kind of landed on needing some middle ground. And there are other services. So if a person would go to the emergency room and they don't need inpatient, they could go to a partial hospitalization or some other outpatient service. But this really is just a step down below from inpatient. So it really provides people with what they need for, at least a couple of days to get people stable and connected in the community to services.
Okay.
So back to your question, yeah, though, why the state decided to focus on this. Again, I think with 988 and really trying to go big about mental health, which, you know, I always like to harp on, the fact that here we are in the 20th century and still stigma is a big issue. And, you know, as they were promoting 988, you want to make sure that people have the services to utilize, have the ways to get connected. So that's really why the state of Pennsylvania is really looking at what do we have and what do we have consistently. You know, every county and how they do it is a little bit different. So they were trying to put the resources out there to make things a little more equitable throughout the Commonwealth.
Okay. Now let's move on and say Holcomb Chimes, or Chimes Holcomb, is the provider of this service. I know they're also the provider of the crisis service you just described, the walk-in and the phone, et cetera. So how did the county come to be working with Holcomb Chimes?
So at the time, Holcomb was not our crisis intervention provider. Mm-hmm. When we actually we worked hand in hand with Community Care Behavioral Health, who is our behavioral health managed care partner, insurance partner, in developing an RFP to put out to the community to get interested providers. So we had a couple of providers who were interested in delivering this service. We went through the normal process that you do. We reviewed applications, we interviewed different providers. We looked at who has experience and capacity for delivering similar kinds of services. And so at the end of that whole process, the provider that we landed upon was Holcomb Chimes. And then after that, when Service Access and Management, SAM, decided to no longer deliver service, and we were looking for a provider of crisis intervention services, actually, it made a lot of sense that they were interested in also stepping up and becoming the provider of that service. So now we're fortunate to hopefully have both under the same roof.
Yeah, that's exciting. It really is. Shall we talk to you, Bobby, about describe the crisis residential program in a broad sense, and then we'll get more specific.
Okay. Before I begin, just one thing I would like to clear up, because this happens a lot when I present. You hear Holcomb Chimes, Chimes Holcomb, what is what? Holcomb Behavioral Health Systems is a member of the Chimes family of services. So Chimes is our parent company, and we're under their umbrella. So if you see them interchangeably, we're all the same thing, but we're just one of the services.
Well, what's the best way to say it?
Well, right now, Holcomb.
Okay, just Holcomb.
Yeah,
okay.
Holcomb. Yeah, Berks County, Holcomb.
Okay.
All right. So basically, a crisis residential is a voluntary, subacute living arrangement for individuals in need of short-term stabilization in a supervised, non-medical setting. Basically, it's an individual who needs a level of care that's higher than outpatient, but less than inpatient psychiatric treatment.
And higher than partial.
Yes, and hired in partial. Partial okay. be included with that, with the outpatient,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Where is your program located?
We're located at 401 Buttonwood Street, West Reading, PA, 19611. It's the same location as our crisis center. So the building is basically split in two. One side is crisis, one side is our crisis residential.
Right. If I'm an individual who needs the service and I find myself in your program, tell me what the individual can expect if they are now enrolled in this crisis residential program.
Okay, well, our program has a lot of facets to it.
Yeah, that's what I want to hear about. Okay,
so one is the day is structured. Okay, so it is a home-like atmosphere, but it is structured. So three times a day, we have groups, group therapy, and sometimes we'll have individual group. You probably have that once a day or once every 2 days. But every day will be a group therapy group three times a day. We use dialectical behavioral therapy. That's the model that we use. So you'll have that, and in between, there'll be life skills such as cooking. The meals will be prepared jointly by staff and residents. There'll be like mindfulness groups. We have resource groups where we can help people, because when they're in this facility, it's for a 7-day stay, and we can try to request to have that extended up to 14. But while they're there, we're working towards a goal. So every day they're working towards a goal, and the day is segmented so they can make progress, make steps towards that goal.
And again, we didn't really say this, but it's a voluntary program.
Yes, it's 100% voluntary, and the facility is unlocked. So if someone decided that they wanted to leave, of course, if they were a danger to themselves or others, we would discuss with them and try to convince them to stay and use the least restrictive course of action required. But if someone just decided they were done, they can leave.
So it remains that if someone needs to be in and they're a danger to themselves or others, but they don't want to be, that person will probably go to the emergency room because they don't want crisis residential, they don't want intervention at all.
Yes, we would assess that person to determine what was the appropriate level of intervention. And that's the beauty of having our crisis department in the same building. Yeah. We can have them come to assess as well.
You know, because I was doing this a long time ago, I mean, this is kind of like a dream come true for, you know, people who've ever worked crisis.
Mm-hmm.
This marriage. Tell me about how large the program is. What's your capacity for serving people?
Okay.
How long might someone expect to stay in the program?
Okay, well, we're a 6-bed facility, so we can have a maximum of 6 people at any given time. And when people come, it's a 7-day stay. But as I said before, depending on the progress someone's making, if they're still in crisis, we can submit a waiver to request that they can stay up to 14 days. Mm-hmm. So I would say 7 to 14 days stay, typically.
Okay. You said a non-medical unit. What if a person needs medication?
Well, on our staff, we have an LPN and we have a certified nurse practitioner, and that's the person who'll be doing some of the psychiatric evaluations mm-hmm. and the med reviews. And they can also write medications or dispense medications as well for residents that come in. Mm.
Again, that was a weakness in the program years ago.
Mm-hmm.
A person that needed meds would wait.
Yeah, well, there's 2 ways that would happen. So when people come into our facility, we do an extensive biopsychosocial suicide risk assessment, but we also will have, if they're coming from another facility, we'll have meds that we can review to determine, okay, are these meds working? Do they need an adjustment? Do they need a different type of medication? So those are all part of the initial assessment when people come into the program.
Okay, and tell me about who would be what is the demographic of the person that could best use this service?
Okay. Well, what I'll talk about then is for the referrals. So we have 3 ways that people can come to our program, and the way they come to us would determine their needs. So someone can come to us as a step down from an inpatient mm-hmm. facility. They were there voluntarily, but they still need a higher level of care, but not inpatient. They can step down to us. We can be referred to for someone who's currently in a partial program or someone who has outpatient therapy. Their provider feels as though, okay, look, this person is struggling with depression. They're not suicidal. They don't have a plan, but they would stand to have a better community resource other than inpatient treatment. That's someone who we can take in our facility. And then we have people who may come to us through a walk-in or crisis contact. And we might determine, okay, this person is struggling with situational stressors that are exacerbating an underlying mental health condition, and that person may benefit from being in our program as well.
All right. So the existing people might come to you and they're already in services.
Yes.
They could be from a partial, they could be an outpatient, and then you have people that maybe have never been in services mm-hmm. until this particular crisis, right?
Yes.
And so assessment is the key.
Yes.
When they get there.
Yeah, we have a thorough assessment within 24 hours of someone coming to our program. They'll have a medical evaluation, mm-hmm. psychiatric evaluation, and history too. That biopsychosocial is key. If we know what happened, helps us determine what needs to be done to get the person in a safe environment and get them the treatment that they need to return to the community ultimately.
Okay. Now, you say there's a 7-day, and then I think, Pam, you said that but people can stay till 14 days. How is that determined?
So I can answer that.
Yeah.
When we initially submitted our proposal, because it's a licensed service, there are criteria that the state has in terms of what a service looks like, how long it can be for. So when we submitted our proposal, we knew from the get-go that there was a strong chance that it was going to take longer than 7 days for many individuals. So we were very clear in our application that from the beginning we would submit a waiver request of the licensure to have it be limited to just that small period of time, that we would want up to 14 days to be able to help resolve someone's situation. And just thinking a little bit about what Bob, you said, I mean, one of the appealing things for us in terms of looking at crisis residential as a service, and he talked about how it's not a medical model, was really looking at something that was a little more recovery oriented. So built into that process, there's peers who are part of delivering service. And then the other big thing in terms of length of stay, one of the things that we know for sure, and Bobby touched on this a little bit, is a lot of individuals are suffering with other things that are kind of precipitating the crisis. It could be, you know, food insecurity, housing, all those other things that come alongside of that. And we know that sometimes those situations aren't something that can be solved on the spot, which is why we really feel like in some situations we need more time to be able to work with someone. And Holcomb will work with whoever is already surrounding that person, whether that's their treatment staff, family, whoever the person is willing to let in terms of trying to figure out how to stabilize and how to get to the next phase.
Okay. Going back to something you said, Bobby, and I don't know if I understood it when you're saying it can be a step up or a step down.
Yeah, when I said step down, so the maximum extent that you can do is the inpatient psychiatric treatments.
Right.
But you can step down from there. Since we're in between, that's the beauty of the program, we're in the middle. For many years, it was either inpatient or outpatient. So we're providing that middle ground.
Right.
So a lot of people will benefit from that temporary stabilization that they need. A lot of times I use this analogy, if you and I were in this room and you were trapped in this room, but I had directions for you to get out, and the music is turned up loud and you can't hear me, your chances of you getting out of this room would not be high. In the residential, that noise sometimes from the outside can be situational stressors, it could be family relationship, it can be food insecurities. Those external stimulus sometimes prevent people from focusing in on their treatment. We're providing people that 7-day respite to be able to take in the information that they need to help contribute to a favorable outcome or the outcome that they desire.
So in someone that's an inpatient, let's say voluntarily inpatient, the inpatient unit can refer to you for an individual to leave the unit and come to crisis residential?
Yes, so they would submit to us a referral, and we're still working on our referral process. Not we have it, but we're fine tuning it since we have a little time. But if they send us a referral form, we would look at it, our certified nurse practitioner would look at it to see if the person is even a candidate for us medically and psychiatrically. And if they are, then we would facilitate that person coming to our facility, presuming we have beds.
Okay. You have the crisis center, you have the crisis residential center. Are some of the staff interchangeable or it's pretty separate?
Well, the plan is for us to cross-trained staff. So
okay.
The crisis interventionists
Good.
Can
Good.
Do most of what our crisis counselors and crisis specialists and a residential program do. They would be afforded the same opportunities to have those same trainings in DBT, things like that, of that sort.
So you'll have crisis interventionists in the residential program. You'll have the nurse practitioner, an LPN. Any other staff?
Like Pam said, we have a peer specialist.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, we'll have a peer specialist, and the job of the peer specialist will be, one, to have a common ground with the residents there, but also to help them with outpatient services. So when people come to our program, we're already thinking, okay, once we stabilize, working towards stabilization, we want to make sure that they have the appropriate community supports to support them when they are discharged. So we're not discharging people out to the street or without maybe an outpatient program or something just to support them in the community. Mm-hmm. Medications, we'll get that set up as well. So we don't want anyone to leave until we have a good safety net for them created.
Okay. It's been a long time since we talked about peer specialists on this program. So I think we should tell the audience what that peer specialist program is. I don't know who wants to field that.
We don't have a program per se. Our current peer specialist is someone who we hired who went through the proper certification.
Well, who are peer specialists?
So do you want me to take that? So certified peer specialists are people who've been in the shoes of a person who's utilized service, someone who has firsthand experience, but they're far enough along in their recovery that they're pretty stable, and now they can make their service available to someone who's experiencing a mental health issue. What we know is that sometimes that connection between someone who's had a similar, walked in your shoes, if you will, mm-hmm. that sometimes that makes a bigger difference in terms of engagement, getting people at least started, maybe looking at things from a different perspective. But as Bobby said, to professionalize the service, there are requirements. There's a training mm-hmm. program that people have to go through.
I believe they get certified. Is
Correct.
That the word?
Yes.
Certified. And it's a statewide program certification, and again, that was another piece missing when I was in the crisis field, and it was another piece that would have been very helpful.
I mean, all the time we have providers that provide certified peer specialist services out in the community,
right.
But to your point, I mean, again, we don't have many hospitals that have certified peers, and we as a crisis provider, again, we don't have that built into our crisis service array. So the fact that this is a service that will have that, and we'll be able to, again, you really need to, when people are in crisis, you need to be able to meet them where they're at. And sometimes using a peer is how you get started, how you make that connection. Again, because the person has some relatability. They've had some experiences, so they understand, and they're able to maybe talk to the person in a different way because they've experienced it and they know what it's like to be on that side of,
right.
of things.
I've personally met people who are peer specialists, and I'm always impressed with the dedication and the knowledge and how you can take your own life experience and help it benefit other people. That's really good. There is another question. Don't ever get old, and maybe it'll come to me. We have about 5 minutes to go. Anything else that we didn't bring up or that, I know what I want to ask you. I know the program the crisis residential isn't open now. When do you hope to?
Okay. Our goal is to open sometime late fall, early winter. So we're aiming for the month of December.
Okay.
We're aiming for.
The best way to access crisis residential when it's open, how do we contact you?
What'll happen is we do have a number for the residential. What we'll do is when we're ready to be open, the county has a distribution network where they'll send out all the information needed to all the providers in the community to call mm-hmm. us. But now if anyone has any questions about the residential program, you can call the crisis department and ask for me, Bobby Sanders, or you can email me if you need more information about the program. But as I said, it's not open yet, and we're very close. We're just fine-tuning a couple things.
Okay.
And hiring.
Good.
Jim, if I could add one other thing, and
yes.
I think Bobby started to highlight this, but some of the personnel that are involved in the project, like the certified nurse practitioner and other nurses, I mean, that's one of the things that you have to work through in the beginning, and I know we've talked about this before, is really making sure that there aren't any other medical issues going on that are contributing to a mental health crisis. So that's a big part of the beginning steps of mm-hmm. the assessment that are done, or trying to make sure that there's not any situation here where the person's medically compromised and doesn't need other kind of care rather than the crisis residential service. So that is a piece of what they're going to weed through. Either, you know, maybe a person's already been to the emergency room and they've already gotten clearance, or if not, figuring out how to get that, figuring out how to sort of tease through that and make sure that there's not something else.
And if they haven't been to the emergency room, the nurse on staff can do medical clearance to, like you said, make sure there's not some precipitating medical problem.
Jim, I wanted to bring up, too, the referral requirements, since we talked about that.
Yeah.
So anyone coming into the facility, one, they must be a Berks County resident. They must be 18 years of age or older. They must have a mental health or co-occurring disorder and be at risk of hospitalization. The individual also either has to be uninsured or have medical assistance in Berks County CCBH. Mm-hmm. And the person cannot be in need of skilled nursing. So the person would have to be able to tend to their own needs.
And that would be determined in the beginning, the assessment, that they don't need skilled nursing.
Yes.
Well, I'm excited. I know you are. You both are, because it's been a long time coming. My guests today have been Pamela Seaman. She is the MHDD administrator for Berks County. Bobby Sanders, who is the director of crisis services for Holcomb. I'm glad you're here today. If you have one more thought, you can. If not, we'll...
I have one thought.
I love it.
We're always hiring. So if you're interested, www.chimes.org. If you're accessing us on a computer, top right hand corner says careers. If you're using your phone, it's all the way at the bottom of the screen. But chimes.org.
And we did talk before that there's a really great training program. It's not like you're going to get thrown in cold.
Yeah, we're very gentle.
Right. That's very good. Well, thank you for watching Talking Mental Health. We will see you next time.
Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.